So this is Mongolian Empire, the next chapter for 11th class history in the series. So long time ago, 13th century, the Mongols are nomadic tribes who for centuries wandered the highlands and plains of the Mongolia, fighting one another and seeking the pasture for their herds, that is the steppe in the Central Asian region. The Mongols were incredible warriors too. Early 13th centuries, so Genghis Khan unites Mongol tribes. Genghis Khan means ruler of the world. So these are the various tribes like Namans, Merkits, Tatars, Khamak, Mongols, Karaites. These are the Mongol confederation which unitedly fight for the Mongol Empire. So this is in a cartoon, you can understand some meaning about it. So war strategy and tactics used bows, arrows and sword, but also cannons and a new technology. So skill attacking on horseback, trick their opponents, often flagged a retreat to lure enemies into a trap. So please have a look on these retreating and tactic manners of war, the art of war that come from the Mongolian land. So this is a caracol tactics. इसमें हम देखते हैं कि घोड़े आगे जा रहे हैं और पीछे घूम रहे हैं. So in this manner they keep on sticking the arrows to the enemy. Open the end tactics. A siege machine which was basically used to invade the place. Okay, so this is a tool. There were 3 rounds of rotating archers, and the bows were light and could shoot with a deadly accuracy straight to the bullseye even from hundreds of meters away. So after the archers, the lancers attacked on the enemy. So this is a tactics for them. So the lancers and bows arrows were very light and small, and this was needed because the Mongols' favorite way of moving from place to place was on a horseback. Kept many horses with them, and these horses were nearly no more than the ponies comparatively small in size for fighter horses. So talking about the military, the Genghis Khan put absolute trust in his general, regarded them as a close advisors also, and he allowed them to make decisions on their own. This is the Mongol Empire, entire on the Russia, China and Turkey region. In 1215, the Genghis Khan forces had destroyed the China capital city and gained enormous wealth. The Mongol extended their conquest and they turned westward across Asia to Russia. In 1216, the Mongols' brutal advance was finally stopped in Palestine by the army of the Mamluks, the Turkish ruler of Egypt. And in 1219, Genghis Khan forces captured most of the Central Asia, including the trading cities of the Tashkent, Samarkand, and Bukhara. So this is a death and burial. in August 1227 during the fall of Yen Chuen, the capital of Western Xia, Genghis Khan died, and Genghis Khan asked to be buried without marking according to the custom of his tribe. After he died, his body was returned to Mongolia and presumably to his birth place. In 1227, the eastern part of the Muslim world had fallen to Mongols, and the largest empire Mongols built the world had ever known. So this is the Mongol Empire, late in 13th century. So you can here find it out the Golden Horde, Chagatai Khanate, Empire of the Great Khans, Yuan Dynasty of China, and Delhi Sultanate as well. So in 1229, Genghis Khan, third son of Dai, became his successor and continued to expand the Mongol Empire to the Karakoram. And Karakoram became the capital city for the Mongolia. Moved into the Eastern Europe, conquering city-states and principalities of the Russia, Ukraine, Belarus, including the major city of the Kiev also. Now Kiev fell in 5 days and massive onslaught took place. Divided among several princes, the most powerful was Kublai Khan, ruler of the Chai Khan. So on a greater context, we found four separate Mongol Khanates being established, and the first was the Golden Horde of Russia by Batu Khan, Dail Khanate and Persia by Hulegu Khan, and the Chagatai Khanate Mongol comprising of the Chagatai Khan, and the Yuan Dynasty in China led by Kublai Khan. So this is the Golden Horde at the time when Batu stand forward as the Mongols word for camp. The Mongol allowed the Russian princes ruled their state as long as they continued to pay tribute of the money and give labors to the Mongol rulers. So when his grandson Hulagu invaded Persia's throne in Baghdad in 1258. So Mongol plundered and killed with service with a year later. Syria was also marched or looted by the Mongols. In 1271, the Great Khan named himself the founder of the Yuan Dynasty in China and moved into the earnest to finally conquer the Song Dynasty. The last Song Emperor surrendered in 1276, and Mongol victory all over China was made at that time. Korea also forced to pay tribute to the Yuan. So this is the Mongol Empire again in 1294, at the time when we are talking about India, when Alauddin Khilji was there. By the beginning of the 14th century, the Muslim world seemed secure, and the Muslims had recaptured the first Christian state founded by the Crusader in the Near East. The Mongols were converted into Islam now. So this is the Pax Mongolica, that is known as the Mongol Peace. It was a period of time where peace, stability and economic growth, cultural diffusion and development were happening around the Mongols occupied territory. In addition to establishing a worldwide trade system, the Mongols also developed a postal system that was called Yam. So in the late 1300s, the Mongols once again menaced the Near East. So Tamerlane leads new Mongolian invasions, son of a Central Asian chieftain who claimed descent from the Genghis Khan. Talking about the organization in accordance with the Mongol civil code and social structure, arts, Mongolians and firm discipline provided the backbone of the military. So the leader on each level had a significant license to execute their orders in way they considered the best, and this was also told us by the Italian explorer Giovanni da Penna del Capitano, that Mongols were the most obedient people in the world regard to their leaders. So
talking about the mobility, each soldier maintained 3 to 4 horses. They had to maintain it, and changing horses often allowed them to travel at high speed for days without stopping or wearing animal out. During the invasion of the Hungary in early 1240s, they covered 100 miles per day, which was unheard of any other army at that time of the world. The Mongols protected their horses at the same they did themselves, and covering them with the armor. This armor was divided into 5 parts to protect every part of the horse. So talking about the training and the discipline, the Mongol army practiced the horsemanship, archery, unit tactics, formation and rotation over and over again. And this training was maintained by a hard but not unreasonable discipline. All members had to be unconditionally loyal to each other and their superior, and especially to the Khans. If one soldier ran from the danger of the battle, then he and other 9 comrades from the same armband would face death penalty together. So this is about the logistic and weapons. There was a food supply, communication. Mongol Ko, the primary weapon of the Mongol forces, sword, fire weapon and the gunpowder, and the catapults and the machine. So these are the logistic and weapons for the Mongol army. So why the Mongol Empire declined? There are multiple reasons. First, the disintegration of the empire, invasion of the other empires, rebellion in the Golden Horde against Mongol rule, and the result of the internal factor. The Mongols were ruthless fighters who had extensive knowledge of the art of war. It was with this trait they helped shape a major chunk of the history. Now, again, this is a map for the Mongol Empire before 1259. Campaign under Genghis Khan, campaign of his successor also. Have a look. So this is the exchanges during the Mongol era from Europe, from Southwest Asia, from South Asia and from East Asia. So these are the commodities, these are the things which were actually exchanged by these Mongol people at that time.